Good morning, Oakview. If you'll stand and worship with us this morning, we are so glad that you're here. Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. Everything around me shaking. I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. He's never let me down. He's made I've still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense, so I won't be going under. Not held by my own strength, 'cause I built my life on Jesus. He's never let me down. He's faithful in every season. So I would be held now. He won't. He won't. My firm foundation, the rock on which I stand, when everything around me shaking. I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. 'Cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So I would be held now. He won't. No, 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 he won't. He won't fail. He won't fail. He won't. He won't. Good morning, Oakview. We are so glad you can have a seat. You can say hi to your neighbor. I have some friends that are going to come up here in just a second. If y'all head on up here. Jalen and Kate. Yeah, okay. So we are so glad that you are here today. It is an exciting day here at Oakview. Before we introduce my friends, I do have a couple things. If you look inside your bulletin, there is a connection card. It looks like that. That? No? It's in your bulletin, and if you would fill that out, and there it is. So it looks like that, and if you would fill that out, let us know that you were here. If there is any kind of prayer request that you might have or a place that you might want to serve, we go over these and pray over these each and every week in staff meeting. We would just love to know that you were here. So if you would fill that out for us, that would be great. Also, next Sunday, we will be having Baptism Sunday, and we are really excited about that. Yeah. There you go. So we have some students here that we'll talk about later that are going to be baptized, and we have some in both services, and so we're really excited about that, and if that is something that you are interested in, let us know. You can fill that out on your connection card and put it in the generosity box in the back on your way out. So, but now we'll get to our friends here. We have the Nimitz basketball team, both the girls and the guys here today. So this is, thanks, Sam. So this is something that we do every single year. We sponsor, we have different people who sponsor players by giving them bags and praying over them every week and sending them notes. And so today is a celebration of those two seasons, and we'll have lunch. And so if you're a sponsor, please join us for lunch over in the BEC right after this service. But they just wanted to say a couple of things before we keep moving on, okay?
Hello, my name is Caleb, and I want to thank all the sponsors for the prayers and the support this season. It really helped. So thank you.
Hi, I'm Jada. I'm a senior. I've been on varsity for about 3 years, and every year they give us gifts and they pray for us. And it being my last year was really just helpful to have the gifts and all the prayers and stuff. So thank you so much. You know, the prayers went a long way.
Same for me. Oh, wait. My name is Jasmine. Same for me. I've been on VAR for about 3 years, so every year is a blessing to be sponsored by my people. So I want to thank y'all so much for that, and thank you so much for the support this season.
My name is Jalen. I appreciate y'all for all the love and support and the strength and the prayers. God bless y'all. I love y'all.
Thank you so much. We do want to say thank you to everybody who has supported a player, sponsored a player, and everybody who's prayed over these players over the last several years, not just this year. It's a program that helps us reach our community, and it's one of my favorite things that we do. So if you'll stand and continue to worship with us.
I've got a friend closer than a brother. There is no judgment. Oh, how he loves. I've got a friend. He is my strength. He is my portion. With me in the valley, with me in the fire, with me in the storm. Let all my life testify, hallelujah, we are not.
This is our hope.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.
And I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm.
The storm. magnificent and wonderful towards you, God, that we would praise you in the storm and praise you when we are celebrating, Lord. And I pray that all of our praises would fall upon your wonderfulness and you would just honor us. We just thank you so much. We just love you. In Jesus' name.
Let him turn it in your favor. Watch him work it for your good. He's not done with what he started. He's not done until it's good. So let him turn it in. Watch him work it for your good. He's not done with what he's done. He's not done till it's good. Hello, peace. Hello, joy. Hello, love. Hello, strength. Hello, hope. It's new. Hello, peace. Hello, joy. Hello, love. Hello, strength. Hello, hope. It's a new horizon. So if you're ready for a breakthrough, just open up and just receive. What he's pouring. Goodbye pain, goodbye grace, it's a new horizon. goodbye fear, goodbye guilt, goodbye shame, goodbye pain, goodbye great. It's a new horizon.
Let the light in, let the light on in.
It's a new horizon. Goodbye fear, goodbye guilt, goodbye shame, goodbye pain, goodbye great, it's a new horizon. Goodbye fear, goodbye guilt, goodbye shame, goodbye pain, goodbye great, it's a new horizon. Amen.
Your Bible, we're looking at Jonah chapter 1, and if you want to use that pew Bible in the rack there in front of you, we encourage you, that's page 795. It's in the Old Testament between Obadiah and Micah. It's a minor prophet, it's a little book. It's not a minor in the sense of importance, but minor in the sense of size. And I am so excited today about what's going on. We're so excited for these players that we get to recognize, and man, I appreciate what each of the ones that were up here said, and I know you guys have sensed how much we love you and how much we want the best for you, and I hope you feel that today as well. And so we're praying for all of you and glad you're here. Really especially appreciate these coaches. Could I have the coaches just stand for a second? Let's appreciate our coaches that are here. Let's give them a big hand. Yeah, yeah. Wow, good job. A lot of respect for coaches and what they do on and off the court, and in this case, just do a great job. So we're in this brand new series called that's on the Book of Jonah called "Loving Our City," and I mean, most of us, or some of us, know. How many of you know basically the story of Jonah? Most of you heard of Jonah somewhere, yeah. What's the first thing you think of? The big fish. You pretty much know the story, right? You know, it's about a guy who doesn't do what God wants him to do, and God puts him in the belly of a big whale, and he lights a candle, and the whale goes, throws him up on the shore, and he gets to be a boy for the rest of his life. Remember that story? No, that's not Jonah. That's Pinocchio, okay? Sometimes we get confused, okay, in the Bible. Okay, this is not, here's the difference. Jonah is a real story that really happened, and Pinocchio is a fairy tale that was made up and written by someone, okay? Jonah wasn't written for kids. In fact, there's nothing really here. It's not really a kid's story. It's probably the best known story in the Bible and the least understood book of the Bible. And so most people don't take the story seriously. But if you look at the scripture, look at the Bible, in 2 Kings chapter 14, verse 25, it confirms that Jonah was a real prophet who lived 2,800 years before, 2,800 years ago. During the reign of King Jehoiakim the second. So there's like a specific time and place that he lived and died and served. And then in Matthew 18, which is the New Testament, so in the Old Testament, he's talked about. And then in the New Testament, Jesus speaks about Jonah. And the religious leaders asked Jesus for a miraculous sign. And Jesus said to them, he said this, "I'm not going to give you any more signs except the sign of Jonah. Just as Jonah was in the belly of the great fish for 3 days and three nights, so will the Son of Man, me, be in the earth for 3 days and three nights before I'm resurrected, before I'm brought back to life." So I'm going to ask you to journey through this book of Jonah for the next 4 weeks. I hope, you know, you'll not just be here today, but you'll come back for this. We just believe there's a there's kind of a progressive building. We saw this when we talked about the Lord's Prayer. This is a four-part story. This is four acts of a play, if you will. We'll get to the first chapter, go through the first chapter today. But if you've heard the story 100 times, or maybe you've never really read it through at all, except for the way it's been told, I'm gonna ask you to try to hear it today in this series for the first time. And I want you to think about it not just from the angle of what is happening in the story, but where you are at in the story. Because here's the way the whole story, we are in this story. We are actively involved in this story and how we live our lives. And so these two stories are going to cross, our story and Jonah's story. And so, if you see yourself in the story, and I certainly see myself in the story, because here's what happens. Like Jonah, we run from God. And like Jonah, we rebel against God and his commands. And like Jonah, we resent the fact that the people that have hurt us get grace from God, that God does good things for them if they'll turn from their sin, and that's hard for us to understand. And here's the thing. Don't let the part about the big fish throw you off in the story, okay? Some people get hung up on this, and it causes them to not get the rest of the story. If God can raise Christ from the dead after 3 days, I think he can create a fish that could keep Jonah alive for the same amount of time, right? So we'll just go from there. So let's look at Jonah chapter 1, verse 1. Here's what it says. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai. And here's what he said, verse 2. Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because the wickedness has come up before me. So here's the thing. Jonah was a prophet in the Old Testament. There were prophets and there were priests, and priests did what our worship team did today. They led the congregation in worship. They were part of that's their whole thing was worship. Prophets, there were lots of priests, but there were only a few, and usually just one prophet at a time in the nation of Israel. And here's what prophets did. They were reformers and activists and troublemakers who stirred up things to get the attention of God's people. It's like they did really some crazy things. You look at the Old Testament, and prophets did some crazy stuff. But here's what they were doing. They were warning people about God's judgment, so they had to get their attention. And so they would do these bizarre things, or these powerful things, or these out-of-the-ordinary stuff. So Israel had lots of priests, only one prophet at a time. Here's why. Because they could only stand one prophet at a time. I mean, these guys, they were just powerful people. They had a lot of power from God, and they had a big message from God to share. So if you're taking notes, and I hope you will, and if you didn't get one, I hope you'll get one in the future. You've got a pen back there, and we'll give you there's an outline inside that. But here's a couple things I want you to take away. Amittai, remember Nineveh was this, Jonah was the son of Amittai. Amittai means truth. And so in that very first verse, what are you saying? The scripture's saying this. God called the son of truth to tell the truth to Nineveh, this city, this huge city. And then Nineveh was the capital of a place called Assyria. And Assyria was a kingdom at that time that was, it was this massive kingdom. In fact, it had this city, the city of Nineveh, you can imagine would be like a New York City of their day. It had 15 gates, it had 18 canals. For 50 years, it was the largest city in the world. And there was one king that built a palace that had 1.3 million square feet and 72-foot-tall ceilings, if you can imagine. And until 150 years ago, if you lived 150 years ago, you would think, oh, they just made up Nineveh. But they found the city. Archaeologists have found the city, and they discovered it. And now they know it wasn't just in the Bible made up, but there really is this city. But here's the thing about them. They were Israel's worst enemy. I don't know if you have an enemy or a worst enemy, but this was bigger than just a personal thing. This was national. This was the people. The Assyrians were the worst enemy of the entire nation of Israel. And in 722 BC, they would come in, invade, conquer, and carry off 10 tribes, which is 10 out of 12 tribes of the nation of Israel, and just take families and everybody and just haul them off as slaves back to their land, to their kingdom. They'd leave a few, but they would take most everybody away and just capture the whole place. And so they were at that time deep, dark, dangerous enemies of the Israelites. And so one day the Lord comes to Jonah, and there's three shocking words that changed his life. He said, go to Nineveh. And he's like, are you kidding me? I mean, I got to believe this. He's thinking, he's like, are you kidding me? It's a shocking statement. He's saying, go to your enemies. They're not, again, most prophets were speaking to God's people. And he's saying, don't go to God's people. Go to God's enemies. go to these people who are harming and hurting you and offer them a chance to repent and change and be delivered and experience the grace and mercy of God. See, on the other end of preaching judgment was an opportunity for them to repent from it. They had a choice. They had a chance. And Jonah's got to be thinking, why are they even getting a chance? God should just wipe them out. And he wants me to go give them a chance. Now, here, picture this in your mind. What God was asking Jonah to do was like this. By the way, Jonah didn't like God's plan, okay? And sometimes you and I don't like God's plan. We're like, is there another option, God? I don't like this one. But it would be like this. It would be like asking a Jewish man in 1942 during World War II to preach against the Nazis and give them a chance to repent and turn to God and be forgiven. I mean, it's on a lot of levels, that seems crazy. And this is what's going on with Jonah when he gets this. So here's how Jonah's story parallels ours. I'm going to give you three ways that kind of our stories intersect. And here's the first one is this. God calls us, just like he called Jonah, to do something to share his love. I mean, if you have received his love, you're called to share it. If you have been forgiven, you're called to forgive. If you have been, or you are in Christ, you are to tell others about Christ. And so God's word's clear to us, like it was clear to Jonah, you got a world to share with. And it's not just with your words, although it needs to be your words, but it's your life. It's how you love people. It's how you interact with people who are different from you. It's how you even treat your enemies. This is what this message is about. So he's calling us to do something, okay? And it's going to be different people in different circles are going to do it differently. But it's one message, and it's all our responsibility. So God's word is clear. Now, in Matthew chapter 5, last week, we were finishing up the Lord's Prayer out of Matthew 6. And here in chapter 5, in the Sermon on the Mount, what Jesus says is this. He says, you are, in other words, if you are in Christ, if you are a Christ follower, if you're a Jesus follower, you are a light, you know, and you're reflecting the light of Christ. He's in you, but you reflect him to others. And you do that by how you love others, how you care for them, how you show your love, how you sacrifice. So he says, let your light shine. Literally says this, let your light so shine among people that then they see that light that's reflected in you. They'll be drawn to the source of that light and want to know more about Jesus. So do good stuff, but not just to do it good, but to point them to Jesus. So you could kind of sum it this way. Basically, Jesus said this, I've shined a light in your life. Don't hide it from others. Go public with your faith. Let it shine to every kind of person and every place. Be generous with your life to outsiders. Don't spend all your time with insiders. By opening up to others, you'll prompt them to open themselves up to me, to God. And your kindness will help them see the kindness of your Heavenly Father. This is what Jesus said. Now, in Acts 1:8, this is one of the first things he said in his ministry. One of the last things he said was this. I'm about to go back into heaven. He's risen from the dead. And he says this, but you will receive power, and you're going to be my witnesses. You're going to tell other people what God's done in your life, and you're going to show it in how you live your life, and you're going to do it in the city. You're going to do it in Jerusalem and in the greater region of Judea and Samaria, and then you're going to do it all around the world. And it's going to be this story you're going to tell about Christ has done for you. So we all have some way that we all are called to do something to share his love. It's not a suggestion. It's not optional. It's what God has told us to do. And so we know we need to do this, to love all of our neighbors and all of our neighborhoods and to pray for all of our enemies and to serve all of our community and tell our Jesus story at school and at work and in your family and care about and care for those who are different from us. This is about crossing barriers. And this is the whole story of Jonah. Is about God moving him to a place where he's willing to cross some barriers. Some of them in his heart, about how he felt about his enemies, about people who were different from him, different language, different race, different people he saw as scary and dangerous to him, and how God changed, was working to move his heart so he would be willing to share good news with them when he didn't want to. And it seems hard, but Jonah, he was afraid, and he was stubborn, he was angry, he was all those things at once. Sometimes we feel inadequate, and sometimes it seems too hard to do, and sometimes we just say no to God. So Jonah didn't like God's plan, and sometimes we don't like God's plan, but that's it. That's the plan. God wants everyone to know his mercy and his forgiveness, and not just some, and not just to reach a certain kind of people or people just like us, but every person, every world, every country in the world. And this is the plan. And so Jonah was convinced that going to Nineveh was not what was best for him. We do that sometimes to God's plan. And we think, I know you want me to do that. I'm not sure that's what's best for me.
Now think about it. Go back to this challenge. I mean, I don't want to just throw Jonah under the bus here. I mean, this is a real challenge he's facing. This is the capital city of his worst, most ruthless enemy. Assyria was this world power who devastated their enemies, who eliminated threats. They practiced genocide as a matter of just routine practice. Genocide was just how they dealt with people. And they'd either capture you or wipe you out. And then the reputation they had for doing that scared people so much that they would just cave into them. And Jonah was about to, you think about what's going on here. Look at verse 3, Nahum chapter 3. And Nahum is another small prophet, minor prophet, with a big message, who talked about the cruelty of the Assyrians. Here's what it says in verse 1. And he talks about this, and this is describing Assyria as a kingdom, okay? And he says, "Woe to the city of blood." And now this is talking specifically about Nineveh. He says, "Woe to the city of blood, full of lies, full of plunder, all the stuff they've gathered from people they've conquered, never without victims, many casualties, piles of dead bodies without number, people stumbling over corpses." And there is such fear of this kingdom. One of the ways they just terrorize the ones that he conquered is they would come in, they would kill people, and they would just take the bodies and let them rot. They would decapitate the body, and they'd place the head on a pole, a large, long pole, and they would force the family members of the friends and family of those who were killed to carry those poles around the city and march around inside the city with the head of their loved one on this pole above them. This is the kind of people we're dealing with here. They would routinely burn both adolescents, teenagers, and kids alive as a way of just terrorizing. So this is why he's afraid. And he was going to have to give months of his life to leave his family to learn a new language. He didn't know this language. He put his life at risk. And all this so he could warn them of something he thought they probably deserved anyway, which was the judgment of God. And so Nineveh is for us this place. I don't know how to tell you exactly what it is for you, but I can tell you what it is. It is Nineveh is the place for you that God calls you to go to that you don't want to go, okay? And it's a place that you're supposed to serve and share and love, and me too. We're to do this place, and Nineveh is full of danger and challenges and fears, and it would be so easy to just not listen to the call or to go in a different direction. So the word has come to you and it's come to us, to me, and here's what it said. This is what I want you to do. I want you to go and forgive that person that's hurt you. And we say, God, that's not a good plan. I don't like that plan. Got a different plan? Is there a plan B? I want you to pray for those who are your enemies. I want you to care for those and share with people around you, and especially the ones who are close to you but far from God. And then you and I often say this: I understand, God, what you want me to do, but I don't want to do it, okay? I'm not on board with this. And so this is the second part of the story. Jonah knew what God wanted him to do, but he did the exact opposite of what God asked him to do. Because here's what happened. Jonah ultimately, in his heart of hearts, doubted the goodness and the mercy and the fairness of God. And so here's the second way his story intersects ours. Number two is this: if you want to run from God, okay, there's always a boat sailing in the opposite direction of where God wants you to go, okay? There's always a group of people that will applaud you for doing that. There's always an activity that can get you involved in something apart from. There's always time that will be taken up. There's always some way to avoid God's call on your life by doing something else. And we talked about this in the Lord's Prayer. We have this struggle, right? So Jesus said there's a kind of prayer that deals with this struggle. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I mean, I want my kingdom, right? I want what I want. And God says, no, your kingdom is not the ultimate kingdom. My kingdom is. And what I tell you to do is what's going to give you joy and love and peace, and it's going to be blessings to others. And so we pray in all the time, Father, not my will, but your will. Not my kingdom, but your kingdom. Less of me, more of you. And this is the Jesus prayer, right? And so Jesus is telling us there's always this struggle. And Jonah is fighting this battle as well. Because he's saying to himself, not your will, God, but my will. Not what you want, but what I want. And we have this battle between selfishness and generosity. They're fighting at us between being closed-fisted or open-handed. Between hate and love, between resentment that we want to hold on to, or forgiveness that God says, let it go. Between keeping our faith to ourselves, which is our tendency, or sharing our faith in our community. And believers don't set out to become selfish or closed-fisted or resentful or to be silent about Jesus. They don't set out to do that. But they start with a no, and they start with fear, and they start with a belief that God's plan is not what's best. They dig in their heels, and pretty soon they find a boat going in the opposite direction, and they get on that boat because that looks like the ticket out of there. It looks like a better future and a safer place and a more prosperous end to their story. And it begins, and it starts with a no, and it then begins to move them in the opposite direction of God's will. And it takes you to a place, and we've all been there, I know I have. It takes us to a place that we think is best, but it's a place that ends up being worse than we could imagine. It's not ever going to be all we hoped. In fact, it ends up being a place we don't want to be. And so look at verse 3. This is what happens to Jonah. So Jonah, it says, verse 3, but Jonah ran away from the Lord, and he headed for Tarshish. And now this is another town that you've never heard of. It's a big, in fact, not a town, it's a huge city, another city. And he went down to Joppa, that's a port city, where he found a ship bound for that port. And after paying the fare, he went aboard and he sailed. And God says, go to Nineveh, which is due east. And he heads to Tarshish, which is due west. And Tarshish is 2,500 miles away. It is the end of the known world. It would have taken him, by most calculations, commentators say it would have taken him a year to get there. He's going to go on a, this was his long-term plan to avoid God's will, okay? Let me ask you a question. Have you ever had a long-term plan to avoid God's will? You know, it could be a relationship you shouldn't have been. You know you're not supposed to be in there, but you just double down and you're going to go, you know, get more serious about a relationship that you know is not God's will for you. And you know it's not going to lead to a place that God wants for you. Sometimes we just double down. He's doubling down on his plan against God's plan. And so Tarshish was, these were sailors that had ships that were known or represented a lot of things. They represented wealth and self-sufficiency and power. And so Jonah is like saying, I'm going to get on that ship and I'm going to ride that thing in the opposite direction. That's where my future is going to be. And he thinks he's heading to a place of opportunity and security. And that's what we think in our minds. We got this thing figured out. But what he looks at from a human perspective is this. Is wrong, and he's not safe at all. In fact, you've heard this said, and it's a cliche, it's sort of a cliche, but it's true, in that there's no safer place in life than right in the middle of God's will for your life. And if you are doing God's will, and then maybe it feels dangerous or scary, or maybe it feels like you're overwhelmed or under-resourced, you know, seek first the kingdom, Jesus said, and then all these other things will be added to you. You'll have what you need. But just the opposite is true. We do it our way, and we do our will, and the way we want it, it's going to never be resourced, never blessed like God intends for us to be. And so here's what I challenge your thinking of. When you think of Nineveh, remember, that's that place God calls you to go that's scary, that you don't want to go. Think of it this way. Maybe Nineveh is really the only safe place in the world for Jonah. Maybe it's the only safe place in the world for us. That place that we think is dangerous, if it's in God's will, it's the safe place. It's not the dangerous place. And when God asks you to do something you don't want to do, asks me to do something I don't want to do, there's always going to be a boat going in the opposite direction. You know, God calls you to use your gifts to serve others, you know, I know I'm supposed to do that, and not supposed to be all about me. You're going to get busy, and you're going to say, you know what, I got too much going on to help somebody else. I got too much in my life going wrong to be able to be any good. And busyness becomes the boat going in the other direction. I don't have time for this. I don't have time to do this. Lots of places, ways we take off in the other direction. Sometimes people come around us and applaud a rebellion against God is a good choice. And so we find that ship and we ride it. We jump on it. And God says, you know, I want to change this part of you in your life, okay? That's my will for you. And we say, I am afraid and I don't want to. There's always going to be somebody that's going to help you not move in the way God wants you to go. And they're going to help this door that he's opening. They're going to close it and take you a different direction. So here's the problem with new boats, okay? A boat going someplace that looks promising. You bring your old problems into the new boat, and there's, while you may be getting away from something, you carry on to that new boat all the old problems you have with you. They follow you. And let me say this about a church. And I, you know, some of you maybe, this is one of the first times you've been to our church. Maybe you've been here several times. I hope this won't be your last time here. But God has called every church to reach out around us to those who are far from God, not because we're any better. We're, you know, we know we're sinners, and now we understand that God's grace has done a work in our lives. But we're called to love those, you know, to love those regardless of our own fears and our own insecurities, our own seemingly inabilities. We're to move all past that and trust Him for that. And this is called the Great Commission, and it goes to the ends of the earth. It doesn't just start here, but it goes to the ends of the world. That's what we're called to do. And here's what's easy for a church to do. Churches do this all the time. They get on ships going in the opposite direction, and some churches, and I don't want to sound critical of churches, because, you know, by the grace of God, we're trying to do what we believe was right. But it's so easy for a church to hop on another ship, in the ship of convenience or the ship of comfort, in the sense of a church being a, you know, it ends up being a cruise ship, and it's about all about us and about our comfort and what we want's best for us. And God's not called churches to be cruise ships, but to be hospital ships, and to go to places where hurting people are, and to be a place where people can come to get their needs met. This is God's call and will for us. And so, just like Jonah, there's a place and a way He wants us, there's something to do to share God's love. There is also an alternative way that we can run from that. And I'll tell you, this running from God is a theme in some of our lives. We know what happens when we run from God. And He wants to call us back to this place He wants to be. Here's the third way His story intersects ours, and it goes like this. God may, and I think I'll put it stronger, God often sends a storm to get our attention. Amen? Are you thankful for storms that get your attention? I know I am. And it sounds strange to say that, but verse 4, it says this, "Then the Lord sent a great wind of the sea, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up." And not every storm you go through is specifically for you. It's not always about you, but there are times when He'll do that, and it's really an act of grace. Grace is God saying, I'm willing to love you enough. I'm going to shake things up for you enough to get your attention, give you a chance to turn this thing around. The more judgment would have been if He had just let him go to Tarshish and said, have it your way. And when God does, when that happens, that's not grace. It's not as much grace. I mean, God's always going to give you grace, but that's when it gets really hard. And some of us have done that. We've just said, I'm just going to do my thing. But God's going to get His attention, and God at times designs storms to just do that. And He loves Nineveh too much to let one man's disobedience change His plans for their deliverance. So God sends a storm. And the storm was as much for Jonah's sake as it was for the people of Nineveh's sake. And here's the thing about what God's called to do. He has planted you strategically in a family or in a school. He's planted you in a classroom or maybe a workroom or a warehouse or a workbench. Or you've managed a group of people, whatever your role is in work or life, and He puts you there to make a difference to the people that are around you. And He strategically, and our church is in our community to reach out in a world that He died for. And He wants us to use our gifts to tell others. And if you take a boat in the wrong direction, He loves the people so much that He wants you to share with, that He's willing to put you into a storm to get you back on course. So you do His will. And that's true for every area of your life. If you're in an area of disobedience and a time of disobedience in your life, we all go to those seasons, He'll bring a storm to bring you back because He cares about you that much. But He also cares about the people that you are called to help, that you're not helping when you're working that way. So look at this next thing. Your disobedience will cost others. My disobedience costs others. Never disobedience without cost. And it's not just to ourselves, it's to others. So Jonah doesn't go through the storm alone. In fact, he's asleep. He goes in the ship. Storm comes up, he's asleep in the base of the bottom of the ship. The guys on top, seasons, professional sailors, they're scared for their life. It's a terrible storm, verse 5. All the sailors were afraid, and they cried out to their own each their own god, and they threw the cargo in the sea to lighten the ship. And Jonah had gone below deck, where he lay down and fell to a deep sleep. And so they asked him, they figured out it was him. He's like, who's... They believed, they had a faith to believe some person was responsible, and they asked him, tell us what is responsible for making all this trouble for us. What kind of work do you do? Where do you come from? What is your country? From what people are you? Who are you? You know, you're causing all this trouble. And he answered, I'm the Hebrew, and I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land. He said, I'm the reason that you're having all this trouble. And let me tell you, if you're in a season of disobedience, there is a husband or a wife or a friend or a boss or somebody in your life, or if you are a boss and you disobey God, there's going to be innocent people that are going to be caught in the storm. If you're a dad and you're running from God, there's going to be kids that will suffer. And so look at verse 10. It says, this terrified them. And they ask, and this is great, underline this, what have you done? In other words, he's saying, what are you thinking? You know, get off our boat. Go find someone else's boat. Why would you do this to us? They knew that he was running from the Lord because he had already told them so. So the sea is getting rougher and the storm is getting worse. And let me tell you the interesting thing about the story of Jonah. The pagans, which are people who are not of God, are more compassionate in some ways to their enemies than Jonah is to his enemies. They don't just throw him overboard. In fact, they struggle with what to do. Like, we can't just kill an innocent guy here, but we're about to die in this storm. And so they ask Jonah what he should do and what they should do. And he said, throw me over. Well, they first thing they do is they try to row the ship back to shore. And then they cry out to the Lord, and they say, is there any way that we cannot do this? But here's this. We're about to throw him over, but don't blame us for what we're doing to him. Or don't blame, you know, don't kill us for what he's done, and don't blame us for what we're about to do to him. And they throw him overboard. Look at verse 15. They took Jonah and they threw him overboard. And the raging sea grew what? Just like boom. It just went calm. It went dead. And at this, the men greatly feared the Lord, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord, and they made vows to him. They essentially got saved. They became followers of Yahweh, not just Elohim, like God in Almighty, but the God of the Hebrews, Yahweh, and they are sacrificed. They're worshiping. So, and here's what happens. People are getting saved. Sailors are coming to Christ. And Jonah, here's what happened. Most people turn to God after they've been thrown overboard, okay? Jonah's going to turn in his heart, but he's the last one to turn. It's the sailors first that turn to the Lord, and he gets thrown overboard. And I'll tell you this, it usually takes a significant emotional experience before people change. People will hear a message over and over. They'll hear what they're supposed to do, and it doesn't connect until something drives deep in their heart. And you're gonna, and these terrified sailors, they had their moment, and now they are trusting the Lord God, and they're worshiping him, and they're sacrificing to him. And sometimes you run from God, and if you run long enough with a disobedience in your heart, here's what my prayer is for you, and here's my prayer for me, that we'll just at some point say, all right, God, I'll stop running. I'll stop running in my life, and I'm gonna not run anymore, and this storm, I wanna thank you for that. And what happens is Jesus calms the storm. In the New Testament, you know, there's a scene in the New Testament where the storm comes up and Jesus is asleep under the boat, and he comes up and he calms the storm, and he does that in our life. There's always grace. You never fail too far. You never disobey too much that he won't forgive that. He won't restore you. And so we see this over and over. And here's the last thing, one last thought. God has often has an unexpected way for you. There's always grace for our disobedience. And you don't, I don't know where you're at in your story right now, but this is where Jonah is at. Verse 17, and this is the end of Act 1, if you will. Now the Lord provided a huge fish to swallow Jonah. So Jonah is thrown overboard. He's sinking in the sea thinking, this is it for me. I deserve it. I don't want to kill all those other guys. I want the other people to live. And he's in the water, and he gets, what does it say? The Lord provided a huge fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of his 3 days and three nights. And if you ask Jonah at the moment that he was thrown overboard how God would deliver him, I don't think he had any idea. He didn't see any way this was going to end. But God's not limited to the ways that we can think up to be delivered. And God delivered him through a custom-made fish, not a whale, but a miracle fish. And God can do that for you today. And some of you are on a boat heading in the wrong direction right now, and you just got to be honest with this. And sometimes it's for believers who are not sharing their faith in ways they're supposed to, or maybe there's something that's secret that nobody knows about, and maybe it's something just started, or maybe it's something that's, and you're on that, you've taken that other ship, and you're going a different way, and you feel like that's where peace and safety and security is going to go, and God says, that's not the way. Security comes in my will, and for churches and for believers, we're called back into this thing that's saying, we have to see our own sin, our own selfishness, our own self-tendency to look out for what we think's best for us. And God calls us to look out and see what's best for others. And we're in this place now where we're saying, are you running from God? So here's the question, are you running from God? Is there an area of your life that God's called you to that you're moved away from? Do you see that your disobedience is harming and hurting others? Do you see it's causing others? But here's the other thing, it's causing someone that needs the message of Christ to not receive it because of our disobedience. Would you bow your heads with me? And I just want to say to those of you who are Christ followers, we are in this story. This is our story. We get on ships and we go on places and we find ways to go away from God's call to us to do, but God's will is pretty straightforward. We're to love God and love others, and we're to put His will first over our own. That's about as simple as we can state it. And when we don't do that, we don't find a place of security. We find a place of anxiety. And I'm going to encourage you to call you back into that. Just say, just like Jonah, say, Lord, I know I'm prone to do my will. I want to do your will. I'm prone to think about what's best for me. I want to think about what's best for others. I want to serve instead of being served. And just submit yourself and call, and God calls us to that. If you're in a storm right now, ask Him, say, Lord, I get the message. I want to come back to you. If you've never received Jesus, like if you were on the other side of faith, like those sailors were, maybe they had all kinds of gods they were worshiping, but they realized there's just one true God. This is the moment where God says to you and speaks to you and says, this good news is for you, and Jesus died for you, and He loves you, and He wants you to receive that and experience new life in Him. Father, we come today with great joy in our hearts because we realize that in even the worst of our disobedience, we never outrun your grace. Father, some of us have spent a lot of our lives running from you, and we realize it never goes anywhere good. And we never end up in a place that's better than where we would have been if we just followed your will. It's always best. Father, I pray for believers right now that would come to you and repent and turn from that direction away from you, move back towards you and doing your will. Help us to share the good news, even if it feels scary or we feel inadequate, because you'll always give us the grace to do that. Help us be obedient to your plan. And Father, I pray too that for those who are maybe have never trusted Jesus, maybe they've heard about it all their life, but they've never personally said, Jesus, I want this for me. It's not about religion. It's not about what I can do to make myself good for you, but it's about just receiving Christ's forgiveness. He paid the price we couldn't pay. Would you just prompt their hearts? Would you draw them to you right now? Would you cause them to pray that simple prayer? Or Jesus, I want this gift. I want this forgiveness from you. I want this new life from you. And I give myself to you. Just help them pray that prayer, Father, and change their hearts. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let me ask you to just do two things real quickly. And I know we want to wrap up here with really a kind of a neat feature. One is, we are in Jonah, so I hope you'll read through the book. You can either read chapter 1 and 2 or just do 1 and follow the message with the reading. There's a daily devotional you can sign up on your next step. And then there's also an opportunity for us, and I think to be praying for people who are close to you that are far from God, and just to show ways that we can love them and serve them and share your Jesus story with them. It should be a humbling thing that we serve and love those. Pray about individuals who need that and ask God to use you and use situations around you to change their hearts and their lives. And then we encourage you strongly next week. I listened earlier to what Jack was talking about baptism, and we have baptism celebration. And if you're a follower of Christ, or maybe you've trusted Christ, maybe you did it today, we want to know about that. So there's a place to check, I've received Christ, or I want to be baptized, which is the next step after trusting Christ. Turn that in, the connection card, email us, show up, let us know about that. We'd love to be able to follow up and talk with you. And then we've got several being baptized next week. And if that's not the right time, we'll find the right time. What we want to show you now is really a wonderful thing coming out of our student ministry. We've been praying for Dee now a couple of weeks ago. And, you know, there's some wonderful stories about what God did during that weekend through this video. So we want to show you just a real practical way that our church and our student ministry, and appreciate Jack and Elizabeth and our leaders, all of our leaders, are really reaching out to our community and saying, you know, there's good news that we want you to know about. But it's about following Jesus, but about first coming to Him. So here's that video story.
Depth of my shame, Jesus, I need you now. I'm here again, before you I lay all of my burdens down. With my hands lifted high, I will sing, every heart will
I still think it was really fun. And I'm glad that I got closer with other people.
On Calvary's hill, everything changed upon the sinner's tree. You died in my place, beat death in the grave. Yes, you made a way for me.
I liked when everyone came together and worshiped.
Every idol we throw at your feet. Oh, this is surrender.
I feel like D9 was important because the preacher really gets down to a kid level and preaches for us, and it's really good because we get around all other little, not little kids, but teenagers and stuff, and like we all can understand each other because we all come from or think the same thing, but not exactly, and it's just a good experience to have.
Let it be my one desire to run to you, to run to you.
D9 really, like, I've opened my eyes to, like, Christ and stuff like that, and it brought me closer. So this weekend, I noticed that I was ready. I was ready to be saved, and I accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior this D9.
Amen to that, yeah? So, you just heard, so Caden's going to baptize next week, so that means you have to come back and watch Caden get baptized next week. We couldn't have done D9 without your prayers and your support, and we really do appreciate it. And you'll stand and worship with us as we go out to serve the Lord.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock.